Okay, we're going to start our regular old Thursday stream here at the Flight Simulator Center. All right, what's going on today? How's everybody doing? 2 minutes on no drop frames. Looking good. Got to send a message, make sure everyone's alive. Hey there, how you doing, Exxon? Anyway, yes, today we're going to play Flight Simulator, who knew? And finally, today is a guitar day. So as I discussed yesterday, I'm going to do some of my karaoke songs along with, there's a cat right there, cat content, along with the YouTube. And the reason why is because previously the way I did it, I believe things were a little out of sync. So the song playing via YouTube was, I think, delayed for you guys compared to what I was hearing. So, or what you would hear, you heard me delayed relative to the song, I think, one of the two, because I was routing them through different paths. And what I'm going to try doing is when I'm playing back the song, I'm going to switch the mixer over to loop back and turn off, which means I have to turn off the sound capture from that window. But I'll be able to tell from the meters that it all works. What's going to happen is, in fact, you'll see there's going to be three windows. There's going to be a karaoke window at the top. There'll be me playing guitar here, or me singing over on this side, right? It won't be able to tell because it's karaoke, but it'll be slightly out of sync with the visuals. Only the visuals. The audio will be just right. But we're going to experiment with that today and see if it works. Meanwhile, today I'm thinking about a couple of different possible things we could do. With our flight today, one of the things is that in the news, what's out here? The USS America. Oh yeah. What is it? What do we get for USS America? Interesting. Find it there. Interesting. Okay. I've never tried this before, so we're going to try it, but not in the Thunderbolt. It's not going to work. In a plane that could depart from, and one that's been in the news, the Osprey, which is one of my favorite planes. That's the one that's in my, startup screen there. It's a custom, that's a shot of me actually playing the game. Let's try, they're all cool. Let's try this one. Weight imbalance should be 50%. That's fine. I'm not sure what this means, airborne 73%. So let's find out with this plane. This could be a bust, but since I play this game a lot and I haven't tried everything. So we're going to try some things. You know what I mean? It's always fun. And the worst that could happen is we'll start over again and find a different spot and a different plane. Check the audio level here. Yeah, always wants to reset that to something ridiculous. Okay. Yeah, so it put us in the air nearby. Kind of in a steady state. This is the Osprey in kind of a steady state. All right. So, and you can see it's moving pretty fast. This group of ships, which is it's you need a special add-on to get ships that move. In fact, this ship here in front is the one, but not this one, not in this location, that I think I'm landed on in that my startup screen. And then this is the little aircraft carrier, which you should be able to. That it's a smaller aircraft carrier. Well, actually, maybe it's a full-size aircraft carrier. No, it's not. But you should be able to take off some planes and land them on it. Hey there, Science. Thank you for the resub. Woohoo! That was my wonderful Twitch, the new just Twitch built-in Twitch. I appreciate it. For your resub, you get use of that amazing Kench 99 shock emote, which, trust me, gets plenty of attention. We're just gonna do a landing on one of these ships. That's challenging enough. And then, but then we're just to show how dangerous these beasts are. Okay, so first we're moving the nacelles up, so into a position where we can slow down, or putting the gear down, because if we don't do that now, we'll probably forget. I'm gonna try to land on this America here. But we're basically gonna land vertically, like a helicopter. Because that's really the only way I know how to do this. Okay, so we're gonna move these even more vertically. Even more vertically. We should be able to get to like 90 degrees. Oops. Okay, that's vertical. Too much vertical. Give more engine, please. More engine. More engine. Full engine. Should be able to take off out of this. No, maybe not. No? Is that full engine? Yeah. I think we're too heavy. We were too heavy because we had too much fuel. You're trying to land on an aircraft carrier, and I had full torque, 103% in the vertical speed. And if you have enough fuel, it should you should be able to go up. So, we're not going to start from here, though. Hold on a second. I don't want to restart that. We're going to go back to the. I now understand the picture, 75 feet. So it's for a landing there. We could try it again. I could probably figure out how to do that. It's the again, it's a very dangerous plane. One just crashed off in Japan, off with military operations. It's Osprey V-22. So maybe we should just try it again until we get it right. Okay, so it says departure, airborne 73 feet. That's not actually what we came in though as. And now what I'm gonna do here is under weights and balance, we're gonna go from 50% to about 20% to represent a realistic, which let's say 21, let's say 20%, to represent a really, and that changes the weight. So it means that we can actually do that transition. Yeah, that's why I'm doing this. It's a very dangerous plane to fly. If anything goes wrong during the transition phase from horizontal to vertical flight, like one of the engine goes out, you're gonna hit the deck. It's very unforgiving, and I've crashed it a million times that exact way. So let's see if we can get it to at least work right. Okay, so we're not at anywhere near 73 feet. So we're at 4,000 feet, which is kind of high because the transition height is about 800 feet. So first thing we want to do is lose a lot of altitude. We're a lot lighter. So we shouldn't have any problem transitioning to vertical helicopter-like flight. And we want to do it at the right altitude, which is about. I mean, this is actually a good kind of angle to come in on. All right, those are down. Let's start transitioning our nacelles up. If you really kind of do, I'm looking at the little, there's a meter there. My math alert shut up. Okay, we should be able to keep transitioning up all the way. And now we should be able to apply power. There we go.
Sink rate, sink rate, sink rate.
That's good. Okay. Oh, yes. Now we can actually control our descent quite easily with that. So we're gonna let the this ship kind of come out under us there. Bunch of them right here on the deck here. So it's about as good as you can really get. Whoop. You basically do a like, ow, what's that? Oh, that's bullshit. That is baloney. Oh, it's because it's moving. It's having trouble. It doesn't really understand. Okay, yeah. There was a perfectly good landing, but helicopters and other craft can't land on moving ships because they don't take on the movement of the vessel underneath it, so they're effectively still, the vessel keeps moving underneath it, right? They're, you know what I mean? It's a known program issue, but the thing is with this plane that I really like doing more than anything is cold starting it anyway. So we'll just do a cold start. We're gonna restart this here. Hold on. Oops. We'll go main menu and because I just want to cold start the plane. It's my most fun thing to do. That's happened before when I landed on a moving ship. Now, on a plane that lands on the deck, I think it works because the plane kind of doesn't expect to have to stop on the deck. But then it will start moving. It'll start rolling. So, but we'll start like on an actual runway, and then it will be nice and would be a nice runway we could find. It does not have to be a long runway. Here's one. But not on the runway, because it's going to be dark. We'll be there. Okay. Weight imbalance. Yeah, let's give us a little more fuel for this operation. Okay, ramp, GA, small, regional airport. Doesn't matter. Just the fun part that I enjoy doing. And we'll talk, because I want to talk about it in detail. People might have heard about the Osprey and another Osprey crash. And there's been four or five, but they are quite a few operational ones. They do have a pretty good safety record, but when they do crash, the people don't tend to survive them because they tend to be pretty, bad. You know, the crashes they do have are bad. And this, the reason is pretty simple, is because they have these two huge power plants on each side. And, they're not like, what can I say? They're not highly symmetric in that regard. In some planes, or they're very, really, or that's not the issue. The issue is the more complicated systems where the whole motor pods can rotate 90 degrees to form, and in fact, they cannot take off like this. Now, this is, you can see that the rotor pods are forward. Everything's cold and dark. There's caps on the insides. You cannot start the engines like that, or the propellers would smash into the ground. But we're gonna deal with that issue. It's a lovely day. So first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna have a look at ourselves around, and we're gonna head up to the battery panel. Oops. Let's see if we can do that here. We're gonna turn a battery on. That's a good thing to do. Now before we get anything going on, there's a small auxiliary power unit in the wing section that can provide electrical and hydraulic power to our systems, which we're going to need. But meanwhile, now that we have some power, we're going to turn on all five of our MFDs that need it. They all have an independent power switch. So we're turning all five of these on. The middle one is especially important because it tells us down here. This one tells us how our hydraulic systems are doing. There's three hydraulic systems on the Osprey V22, one associated with the left engine, one associated with the right engine, and one associated with the APU. And they come up to about 5,000 pounds of pressure. And once they do, we can rotate the wing sections like we were doing before, which we're going to need to do to start the engine. So now we rotate the nacelles to vertical, and that's indicated by 90 degrees on our systems there, so that we can actually start the engines. Although we will rotate the back to taxi and take off. Okay, so what are we at? What are we at? We're at 87 degrees. Let's go up to 90 degrees. All right, so our engines are now at 90 degrees. We can now look at our engines start panel, and we're gonna start our left engine first. So first it goes into crank for about 10 seconds till you hear it crank up a bit. And then it goes into start. Once it starts, now you notice that both, I turned on the left engine and both propellers start. That's because there's a torsion transfer system, basically a drive shaft between the two engines that goes across the wing section. So that if one engine goes out, you still have enough, you get 50% power to both propellers. So both engines are always powering both propellers. Each engine doing and adding their power separately, whereas it looks like they're not doing that. So there's a whole bunch of extra safety system in there to allow for one. Okay, so left engine is in fly mode. Let's start the right engine. Right engine crank for 10 seconds. Let it crank for a second. Put it in start. Now the right engine starts up. And we can see down here, if we look at our... down here. If we look at our hydraulic system, left engine hydraulics are good, APU hydraulics are good, hydraulic system for two, just starting to pressurize now, because we just started hydraulic engine two. And we're seeing engine two spin up right here. Very good. Engine two spinning up, and we can put it in run. Go through these. Engine two is in run. At this point, we're going to disengage and finally turn off the APU, because the engine's put out a lot more power. And so we do not need that third hydraulic system. Basically, we're fully warmed up. I think there's a couple of things we might want to turn on here. These are all pretty much not implemented. I think the barometer works, but I'm not sure. It used to not work. Yeah, everything's pretty much computerized on this. There's a few switches here. I don't know if these do anything. APRS 39. But not actually implemented, but that's a radar system, or a radio system, I believe. Can you open that? No. You can open the main doors, though, which is nice. So, like, if we wanted to open up the doors, there's the side door. The back ramp door, you can see that opening up. You can look into that. It's pretty cool. It's got 22 jump seats in its configuration, which I don't think is typical. 11 on each side. But you could like launch out the back, and then that's the ramp into the main cockpit. Pretty cool. All right, let's close up that bad boy. All right, let's go for a little ride and come right back. Let's kind of go west.
San Luis Ground, KNSH-39er with Mike request taxi for takeoff west departure.
All right, so for taxi, we're putting the nacelles down so that we get some forward motion. We're turning off our parking brake.
Taxi 2 and hold short runway 29.
I'll give you some gas, and you can see we just smoothly make, hopefully smoothly make some power. Don't go too fast. It's a big plane compared to some of these little planes, but it's a small plane compared to like jets and stuff like that. So it's an interesting size just in terms of airport handling. You can see a big, like a big jet down there compared to the size of this and the little planes. Anyway, we are going to go onto the runway. There's those two planes there. But this thing takes very little, it's called a S-tall type of aircraft, very short, or V-stall, a very short takeoff. We can tell we're ready to go.
San Luis Tower, KENSH, Tree 9.
You don't set flaps, they're automatic on these planes. Now, the tricky part about taking off in these things is that you really need to over torque the engine to 103%. That is nice, Stanley. A beautiful day. It's the real time weather. You need to over torque these engines to 103%, and you can only do it for about 45 seconds before the engines will explode. So we're gonna get our engines. What happened there? That's never happened. That rarely happens. The hell? No, everything was correct. That was all in the correct regime. Yeah, there's some bugs. All right. That, no, because I've taken off a million times. That was exactly how I do it every time. I have overstressed the engine before, but that's... It's, how can I put this? It's only at higher speeds when your rotors are not forward, when they're at a certain angle and you try to go, I know, when you try to go forward, I'm not going to play with that airplane anymore though, but we still have another 20 minutes of flight simulator content. I don't know what happened there exactly, except as I say, I've seen it over that message that it's overstressed the aircraft, but it's only when you try to go too fast, like you're already in the air and then you move your rotors up too high. It basically means you're overstressing the propellers because they're getting too much side force, and then you crash. But you could see, yeah, I mean, this is a dangerous ass aircraft. Well, the good thing about this is there's actually a few planes I think I've never actually flown. They're not necessarily interesting ones, but at least they're ones that are new to me, or ones that I've been wanting to fly. We flew the 152. We've flown these. We've flown all of them, but pretty much. The other thing is, I'm still planning on getting the actual aircraft carrier that you could do catapult landings and takeoffs from. See, that guy is pretty boring. It takes so long to get the engine started. Definitely I don't like, you know what, we're gonna do a quick little helicopter run, because I wanted to test this new thing. Oh yeah, last time we did the American flag, we'll do the British flag. Last time I did this thing where I've remapped my controller so that I can do the pitch trim on my controller for helicopters, because it's a different set of variables. It's a nice day in this area though, but is there anything to see from helicopters? What I want to know. What's this? Hearst Castle. Oh yeah, we can go check that out. We'll set that as departure. Because we're late, we're going to start the runway. I have started this before, and that's not what I want to test. What I want to test is the ability to establish flight from the from the we'll try the Osprey again. I might try it offline and see if it does that again. But we're trying to have a variety of different aircraft today. But as I mentioned, they are dangerous, and there's a variety of ways you can crash them. Not just overstressing the aircraft to take off. A lot, as I mentioned, that transition's always been hard and dangerous between flying horizontally and then coming in vertically and landing. And as I say, I've done it a million times. It's in fact, that's my starting page that I've landed on the ship. You know what I mean? So, okay, we're already started, which is good. But I have successfully started this craft before, and it is a beauty. This is a new. I bought this new helicopter. So we're gonna see. I have it mapped to X, and then this above. The point is, what I want to do is, okay, Hearst Castle is that way, so we're just gonna go that way. Which direction is it? Basically northeast. All right, we're just gonna give it some moving power. We're at the end of a runway, but we're in a helicopter. We really don't need runways. Smoothly apply power. This is a fast helicopter, I found, compared to some of the others. I'm not sure why. But you can get a good speed going with this bad boy. Up in the top of the hill is the world-famous Hearst Castle, and it's a pretty good model. I've been there a few times. Okay, what we're going to try to do, though, is establish. Establish forward trim to about 30 there. Okay, there we go. Which gives us maybe a little less than 30. And then I want to establish vertical speed of 0. So effectively trying to get a reasonable steady state where I don't have to be putting in any with my left thumbstick. I can turn this way using effectively the rudder controls. But yeah, I think trim. Oops. 28. I'm trying to come up with a good negative trim number. You can see it. It's kind of tricky to do it from in there. It's on the top of the hill, and he's got like a zoo of animals. But it's this is a cool model. There's a bunch of buildings. There's a bunch of outbuildings, and this. Kind of more of a pond than a swimming pool. And then this giant, looks like a Spanish mission style. Whoops. I'm getting used to how I could turn sharply in this without. I wonder if you could land somewhere around there, but I love this model. I visited this place when I was a kid. San Simeon, the Hearst Castle, look it up. There's all sorts of backstory on it. If we could land like in the in the parking lot. You normally can't drive there. You have to take there's a bus shuttle that you get from a parking lot down there, I think. Maybe you can. So anyway, yeah. Okay, so I'm seeing how it handles. This is good because I need to get used to controlling this trim. So if I want to come in and then I want to get the trim back down, the vertical, it's a longitudinal trim, they call it. Which it effectively keeps the helicopter going forward. And yeah, this would be not a lot of fun in real life either. Okay, trim back down to 0, or much less. But just pretend that I know what I'm doing. All right, maybe we can land in the parking lot? I don't think so. These trees will cause you to explode. Not explode, but let's say you crashed. We get nice and close up. So, okay, I've adjusted my longitudinal, it's a hard word to say, trim, so that I can hover. And that's the basic thing for these things. So yeah, there's these buses there. You take the buses. You don't get to kind of drive here unless you work there. Anyway, the world famous Hearst Castle, San Simeon. You can look down and see it from there. You can get closer to the ground here. Fuel level, we're real heavy, 55%. Yeah, we're gonna have to fly another Osprey mission. I mean, it's one thing I like to do a lot. And it explodes every which way. But that was the first time. Well, pretty much first time. Hey, so tomorrow is going to be a recording studio stream from the back. I'm kind of excited about it. Let's see if I can do it right this time. Yeah, we are getting low. How low can we get? This is definitely one of the models you can get close to. Definitely not try to do this in real life. Oh, that's a great effect. That dust effect. I did not know it was going to do that. It probably does that every single time. I just never notice. Hey, get it back on the ground. Oh, no, it's on the ground. No, it's not. I think that's ground level, though. I mean, basically, it thinks it's on the ground, although it seems like it's floating midair. So I've got zero, because I'm holding the power off. And I can't move anywhere. Right. Well, yeah, it's acting like, yeah. All right. What's this thing? That. Okay, we're going to turn off the engine. How do we do that? Isn't there a thing on here? Throttle? Collective? No. Oh yeah, it's on here. Hold on. It's here. Not the floats. Hydraulics. Not many lights. Where's the engine control? Yeah, I'm just looking over these. Did that stuff the engine, or do you need to, there's like a fuel cutoff somewhere. I don't see a fuel cutoff there. Sometimes there's one up here. Well, there is, but this says emergency fuel cutoff, and it's not an emergency. So, I just want to know how you turn it off. Oh, the downwash dust effects is specific to this airplane or this helicopter. Because, yeah, I had not seen it on other helicopters. I don't know why it keeps wanting to show me these parts of the carpet. That is definitely a bug. Altimeter calibration. Okay, yeah, the downwash and the exhaust heat blur. This is bad. Oh yeah, I remember red. Well, it's a $10 thing. Okay, and they gave me 99 liveries. Just trying to see, are these arm sling. What is an arm sling? I don't know. Mirror de-ice, searchlight. Is there oh yeah, there is. That's that thing in the back. Is it on or off though? Nope, it's still there and I just turned it off. Maybe it's turned off. And if I click searchlight on, well, I turned the battery off, so yeah. Okay, if I turn the battery on. Searchlight on. Yes, there is a search. There are searchlights. I bet at night that would look cool. Okay. But no, leave it off. Now the arm floats I've already seen. Yes, you can launch, you can blow these floats and turn it into a water landing helicopter. But that time I tried it, as soon as I tried that, it crashed. What are these? Heading compass. Heading compass, what would that mean? Let's a testing electrical system test. Oh, is there a brake? That's the brake, rotor brake. Can't get it from there. Can I get it from here? Rotor brake. Is that one of those things where it wants the battery to be on for the rotor brake to work? That doesn't make a lot of sense to me, no. Because, yeah, it's the other thing. Time I had some issues with getting these controls to work. But then they started working. Okay. I don't think it's a battery. I just wanted to start up again, which isn't realistic. I didn't do this, I didn't start it up. Okay. Well, a couple issues there. I liked it, it's floating, but that's okay because this isn't necessarily an approved place to land a helicopter. So, unless it is, it's not guaranteed to even let you land. But I just wanted to get up close with the Hearst Castle there, the San Simeon. It's pretty amazing. I mean, imagine this wasn't a hotel or anything. This is just some guy's house. You know, and then the slaves lived in these really nice houses over there. There's like seven of them, I think. There's several indoor pools in there. You can go on tours though. You can check it out. It's crazy. It is cray cray. And this is a pretty helicopter. As I say, it's a good $10 helicopter, but there's definitely things on it that are kind of wonky. Like no rotor, like this. Does this work? Rotor brake. Okay. Fuel cutoff worked, and now the rotor brake works. That maybe they are supposed to be used together. Oh, see, maybe that's the way these things are. That's the other things. I don't know. I haven't tried these before, so I'm learning a lot about the specific systems every time. But again, you can do a water landing because you can blow these floats that are attached that you can't see, but these basically balloon floats that are attached to the landing gear, the skids they call them. And then you can land on water. And I want to try that too. I haven't tried that yet. That's gonna be fun. Anyway, I do got to get to the second half of my stream today because otherwise we'd go too long. But I am trying to make sure I go, you know, I can go a little longer. I can go like an hour and a half or more because I'm trying to like get my hours in. I got like 48 hours in like last month, just or this month in November for streaming, something like that. It's a lot. Okay, well, that was fun. We're gonna switch to the music stuff. Hold on a second here. As I mentioned, so give me about 5 minutes. Hello. Hey, thanks for hanging out with me for the till the music part of the stream. Wow. Okay, hold on a second. Today's guitar from my collection of 16 guitars. By the way, I had this idea in my head for a stream content that I would take all my guitars. They're all here in different rooms. Take all my 16 guitar collection and place them strategically in this area here, and have to take a roving camera and go through them by one count. So people are like, oh, you don't have 16 fucking guitars, do you? This is a G&L. G&L is the company that Leo Fender started after he sold the Fender Musical Corporation, but did not require himself to get a non-compete clause, so or a very short one. So he's able to cut like a couple years later. He's just sit out. He came out of retirement, started the G&L with the George somebody, the other founder of Fender, and they designed a whole bunch of really nice guitars, but he was only alive for a couple of years. That was in the 90s. But the G&L Guitar Company continues on with these fantastic kind of updated designs that are still very Fender, bolt-on four bolt classic bolt-on neck the hard maple neck. And this version is called the ASAT Deluxe. Got a carved top and tribute because it's not the ones that are made in America. It's one that's made in Asia. This one's made in Indonesia, which is a place where a lot of fine guitars are made. Thing I like about this guitar more than a lot of things is that it has a coil splitting feature for the humbuckers, but the coil split humbuckers are just really kind of badass. Unlike weak sauce sort single coil humbuckers. So this is the bridge humbucker, single coiled. Which is a humbucker. If you want more bass, then the single coil or from the neck. That's pretty weak. I don't know why I wouldn't want to use that one. But then you get both. That sounds starting to get kind of interesting. But I still like basically either the neck, either the bridge pickup, split, or by itself. Or humbucker. So I think tomorrow's stream at the recording studio, my plan is to do two things. One is only have two cameras. The only things I want to change, do it like the other stream, but only have two cameras instead of three, and do the recording part correctly where I where the I correctly route the recorded output and just see if I remember how to do all that stuff while in the you know, I know how to do it because I practiced it, but it see if it comes out while I'm having to produce a live improvised TV program for 45 minutes. You know, there's a lot of stuff you can forget. And unfortunately, those meters don't work right. I can only see, it sums the control room and the main output. So I don't know what's really going on each output. It's not good. Rad color. I mean, it's the only, I saw the color that these had. It's, you know, flamed kind of purple blue. I don't know what you, indigo. And it's a very light guitar and it's very comfortable. It's got this, you know, your belly cut away, belly cut here on the back. Very comfortable and light. But still, I like the way it plays. A lot of snap, but a lot of tone. Hey Donnie, how you been? I'm good. About the same. I'm gonna sing a little bit later. Content, by the way. People like it. Thank you. I was watching the streamer from Ireland who plays guitar and sings like an angel. I think Ireland. Oof, God, he's good. And he played this Martin guitar. Oh, it sounded good. I sound like such shit in comparison. It's sad. But I did have one thing he did not have, which is two cameras. All right? I like to feel superior in that way. I mean, he had also had like a Neumann microphone and all sorts of... I mean, it was worth it because he sounded great. I have a good microphone. I have a good mixer, too. It's not great. But I have two cameras. The thing I like about two cameras is you can see my face close up, you know, and I think you need to... I don't want to see my face, but I think other people might want to just get that personal feeling of watching somebody who's right next to them playing the guitar. That's maybe a mile away. And then you want to... I like being able to see the actual instrument being played, and you couldn't see his... He only had one camera, so you could see him... But you can only see the top half of the guitar and not this part. You know what I mean? So, and I'm like, that's subpar. That's not ideal, really. Get another camera. They're not expensive. And a tripod, you know, $80. And then you can get a nice close-up picture of you and a good shot of the whole damn guitar while it's being played. And the same thing with the keyboard. I have a shot of the keyboard where it's behind, kind of behind there. It's a little angled up. You can see the whole keyboard. It's really important to me. It is a good setup. But if I go to some other random music streamer, and I'm like, well, they're really good singers and they're extremely talented instrumentalists. And, you know, I'll never be like that. But man, I would like it even better if they had a good, you know, a setup like mine. You know, and I want to come into the stream and say, hey, you know what? Come to my stream. You'll see a professional, you know, because they're not, you know, that's not how it works. But at least they'll see how somebody else, I think, plays music live on Twitch with two cameras. Because I don't want to change the cameras around. I don't want somebody switching my cameras. I want shit moving around. You can go crazy. They're saying two cameras, you know, if you're going to play a music instrument online, live. No, it is a good setup. I like my setup, especially my backdrop doesn't look cheap, you know, because it's not. But let's move on from that. Now, today, I just warmed up a little bit on the guitar, but I'm going to do what I really don't want to do, which is I'm going to sing. And the reason why I'm going to sing is because I realized after, and it was more of a thought experiment, and then I went back and watched my VODs, and it's when I was doing several of these karaoke with YouTube VODs, like The Killers, and we'll do them today. We're gonna do The Killers, we'll do Human, and we'll do Wish You Were Here, Pink Floyd. And I realized as I was listening to it carefully that the music that was being played back from YouTube, and I'm playing along with it and on the guitar. And we're going to do it. But I realized is that what I'm hearing and what you're hearing is not exactly the same because of the sound path. When I'm on that screen, you're getting that capture sound. But I'm getting the sound that's routed out from... In fact, I'm going to change that over. The thing is... And I wasn't using the loopback function. So in fact, so when I listened to the recordings of it, they were a quarter of a second off sync. So I was late, I think, a quarter of a second. And it sounded kind of bad, I thought. But you had to listen for it. You had to listen for it. It wasn't obvious. But I figured out that all I have to do is remap the sound to my mixer. There's a button on it. There's a three-way switch, and if I turn on loopback, and I'm going to demonstrate what that's going to sound. The reason why is because I'm going to be listening to this VOD later, and I'm going to try to listen to see if it's more in sync. So I'm going to be trying to play super in the rhythm of the playback of what we're going to be hearing here. Hold on a second here. So we'll start. We're going to do "Wish You Were Here," and we're going to do "The Killers." "Human." That's a great song that I love here. Hold on a second here. Okay, so you hear that, right? Or do you hear that? Hold on. Yeah, you do hear that. Cause I can see that's the ad, but I can see the which you should. Well, wait, what is it on here? It's on input mix, so no, I should be able to hear it. Hold on a second here. Skip this. Let's see if this works correctly here. Hello, hello, hello. Hello, hello, hello. Yeah, you can't hear it, but I can hear it. Now watch what happens when I switch to this view. Now you can hear it, because you're getting the audio output capture version of the song. This, right? Now you hear it now. Okay, this, it's all, I know what's going on, because I have mixers. I'm pausing this. That's the song we're gonna do. So I'm gonna turn the audio output capture off. That's the out of sync version. Hold on. The loopback version goes through my mixer. So you hear it. And this should be the synchronized version, not with the video. Okay, let me. Okay. You won't be able to tell because there's nothing on the video that's synced up. But imagine that there were dancers dancing on the screen exactly to the beat. That what I'm doing is effectively tearing, making a sound loop that takes the music away from the video from what you're seeing. Now, it's only a quarter of a second, so there's absolutely no way for you to tell it. But what I'm doing is unsyncing the audio from the video so that it's synced, so that you're hearing exactly what I'm hearing. So we're going to do it that way, and then I'm going to compare this, because I've done this song a bunch of songs, and it's always been a little out of beat. So ready? Let's try it. Right, let me make this full screen here. Okay, back to the beginning. It's gonna be hard for me to play it correctly. Exactly. Trying to be with the beat here. Thank you. volume. The song starts so quiet. But the syncing is going to be great. There's no way of knowing it's out of sync from the 50. All right, we'll do the other one. But my experiment is perfectly exactly what I thought it was going to be. Which is that, yeah, it's fine. I just need to adjust the sound quality. Or the volume level, excuse me, so that it doesn't blow out the meters there. Okay, we got one more ad to go through here. Pause for a second. This is Capo 3. I can't sing the song either. Would I put it this? I did my best to notice when the call came down the line. Under the light, almost surrendered. I was bored, but I was kind. Sometimes I get nervous when I see an open door. Close your eyes. Cut the cord. Are we human? Are we dancer? Or such spider? My hands are cold, and I wonder, is looking for the answer. Are we human? We'll be right back. but I don't even know if I got the chords. I can't really sing it if I can't, not sure about the chords. And I've been playing this song a million times. I should know them by now. Hey, stop. Stop doing what you're doing. Stop doing what you're doing, please. On my screen. I want to do it again, but this time with the accompaniment at a lower volume. Lower volume. And I'm not going to sing it. Not that low. Go ahead and get the chords. Okay, I already missed up there. Hold on, we're gonna get it right. That little part confuses me always. All right, man, I've gone through this enough time. Yeah, I need to learn the... First of all, I can't sing that song. So I'm not gonna... I really should not try. Have I done this one before? Is it a really hard key to play this one in? Let's do it. Oh, he's playing it tuned down. Yeah, it's that can't be done. Okay, he's playing it. That's acoustic guitar tuned down. So he's tuned it down a half step. I'm not going to do that. We're just going to play the guitar. Oops, excuse me. And now the important thing is, well, when I do this, right, does it still come through? I need to turn loop back off because I don't want necessarily... So now you shouldn't be able to hear that. Perfect. Hey there, how you doing, Hunter? On a dark desert highway, cool wind in my hair, warm smell of Carolina rising up through the air. Up ahead in the distance, I saw a shimmering light. Every head, my head, you're having a psycho dim. Had to stop for the night. Oops, I moved my camera. As she stood in the doorway, I heard the mission bell. I was thinking to myself, this could be heaven or this could be hell. Then she lit up a candle. She showed me the way. There were voices down that corridor. Well, I thought I heard them say, hey, welcome to the Hotel California. Such a lovely face. Such a lovely face. There's plenty of room at the Hotel California. Any time of year, you can find it here. Mirrors on the ceiling, ain't bad shape hanging out on ice. And she said, we are all just a prisoners here of our own device. In the master's chambers, gathered for the feast, stabbed it with their steely knives, but they just can't kill the beast. Mirrors on the ceiling, last thing I remember, running for the doors. I had to find the passage back in the place I was before. Relax, said the nightmare, we are programmed to receive. You can check out any time you like, but you can never leave. I forgot the whole second section, which is I forgot the lyrics because she's got Mercedes Benz, got a lot of pretty boys, and she calls friends out to dance in the courtyard, sweet summer sweat. Some dance to remember, some dance to forget. So I called up the captain, please bring me my wine. Said we haven't had that spirit here since 1969. And then those voices are calling from far away. Wake me up in the middle of the night. Well, just to hear them say, hey, welcome to the Hotel California. Any time of year, it's a good song like that. We're living it up at the Hotel California. And it's what a lovely place, such a lovely place. But anyway, I always mix up the second and the third and the second verse, and I should have it written out so I don't forget it, but I don't care so much, you know. Because they don't really make sense anyway, so you can sing them in any order, really. You know what I mean? They do and they don't. Okay, you check in the hotel. I get it. It's the state, or, you know, the state of mind as much of a physical, whatever. But still, it's such an enduring song because of that solo, the way it's... nothing to understand, like any good song. Just enjoy, you know? Absolutely. Okay, I'm gonna sing the song. I do not know the lyrics of the song, let's sing anyway. I'm gonna sing Paint It Black. I'm tempted to. I don't even like this. This is the last song of today, and then tomorrow will be the recording studio stream, which will be a Friday stream. It could be an extended long stream. It might not. Well, we'll see how it goes. I see a red door and I want it painted black. No colors anymore. I want them to turn black. I see the girls with my dress in the summer clothes. I have to turn my head till my darkness goes. seen of course, and they're all painted black with flowers and my love, never to but never to come back. I've seen people turn their heads and quickly look away. Make it do, but maybe it just happens every day. I look inside myself and see my heart is black. I see my red door, I must have it painted black. Maybe I'll fade away, not out of fade effects. It's not easy facing up when your whole world is black. No more will my green seed go turn a deeper blue. I could not foresee this thing happening to you. If I dig hard enough into the setting sun, my love will have me before the morning comes. I see a red door and I want it painted black. No colors anymore, I want them to turn back. Painted black. What does this song mean? Where is that? That's the whole. Oh, no, there's one more. I see the girls. I see the girls walk by dressed in the summer clothes. I have to turn my head to my and I go. What's it mean? Need some little hard rock in there. I'm saying, Black as night, black as gold. I wanna see the sun running up from the sky. Gotta paint it black. Oh my god. It's not a tedious song at all, no. Except for that one while we're doing this here. Oi, I'm gonna trust this will be the last one. I said the last one was the last one. I would do that. World was on fire, no one could save me but you. Strange what desire will make foolish people do. I never dreamed that I'd meet somebody like you. And I never dreamed that I'd meet somebody, lose somebody like you. No, break you up with you. When a wicked game play and make me feel this way, what a wicked thing to do and let me dream of you. Break your heart with you. Wood was on fire, no one could save me but you. Strange what desire will make foolish people do. I never dreamed that I knew somebody like you. And I never dreamed that I knew somebody like you. Ooh, I don't wanna fall in love. This world is only break your heart. Ooh, I don't wanna fall in love with you. I don't know about this guitar as far as just accompanying up a vocal guitar. It's a little weak. Not bad. I've been playing too much today. I've already been playing guitar, and now my hands are getting tired. So that's going to be it for today. Wow. Thank you for stopping by. Tomorrow is going to be a flight simulator. Maybe we'll get a successful flight out of it for change. It was fun. And then, as I mentioned, I am looking forward to doing my second recording studio stream. And we go there, we talk about the synthesis engines, how music comes out of these various synthesizers, or at least what I know about it. And I know a reasonable amount about it. And what makes them kind of fun, you know, to play with and to make music with. And we'll do a short recording and we'll hopefully get it played back. And it'll probably be about an hour's worth of content from the recording studio. So see you then. That'll be Friday stream. And then we'll just keep doing it, see how long it goes. So take care, everybody.